So, hi everybody. I'm very happy to be there today to share with you the lessons I've learned while developing a Google Assistant application. But what was special there, it was a transactional application, which means you could pay, and we are the first French application doing that. This is why I have many things to share with you. So who I am, my name is Marie Terrier, and I am the CTO of Yelda, which is a company developing chatbot, but most of all, a management platform for assistant. And my CEO is maybe most famous for some of you. It is Thomas Genou, the author of the famous CommitStrip blog. So, to start, I will introduce a little bit the topic and do a demo. Then I will spend a lot of time on the technical stack and then focus on the transaction because this is what is new today. And I will share with you the challenges we face by implementing this solution. So, yes, first of all, just to have an overview, who is comfortable with the concept of a chatbot? Yeah, everybody, so I won't explain to you what is a chatbot. In short, it's a program that is able to interact with a user, and in our case, it will be either by message with your Google Assistant on your phone or by voice with a Google Home. I will maybe clarify what is not this chatbot. When I present it to my friends, usually they are telling to me, wow, you should be super smart, doing machine learning and stuff. Let's be honest, no. The smarter thing I'm doing is maybe some switch case and if else, but nothing more. When we presented the project to the client, he was thinking that because Google Home was able to speak with a voice, it would be like a human. Once again, no, it's still a bot. It will be super dumb as you code it. My mother, she was just believing I would develop the next Terminator. But to be honest, most of the time, I'm just saying silly things to my chatbot and I just check if it's not too silly too. So, quickly, a small demo. I didn't bring the Google Home because honestly, the demo is failing super often. So, right now, I will use Visor, and you are seeing my screen. So I just hope my friend won't send me some weird message. Oh no, okay. 1 second. Where is my mouse here? I just need to find my device again. No, I need to kill this one. Oh, of course it was working like 2 minutes ago. So, I will explain while I'm finding again my device. Okay, I don't know what's happening. Well, it's okay. I did a record of the video. Don't be afraid, you will see a lot of slides. In fact, I have half much than what I need. So, really? Ah, okay. Okay, thank you. Yeah, it's working. So, first, what's happening? I invoke. Oh la la. Yeah. Stop it. Yes, so what's happening when you are using Google Assistant? You all have it on your phone. I mean, at least if you have an iPhone or an Android. Well, I will let the loop go on. It's fine. So, first of all, when you are in Google Assistant, everything you say, it will be handled by Google Assistant. But once I invoke my app, and I know I am in my app when I have the top header, black header, saying the name of my application, I am inside my application. So what I did was saying parler with Fnac. So once I am in the context of my application, it's triggering what we call an intent. Here it will be the welcome intent. I will show you just after. Oh, it's very weird to see it moving without me directing the video. So let's go back. Yes, so what's happened here? You are having a welcome message, then you are having some chip, so you can select a product. Yeah, thank you. Okay, anyway, so, or you can ask by voice, I want to order the best sales of books. It will understand best sales and books, or you can use some chip if you're guide, and you will see this nice carousel. And if you were watching the video just after, then it's asking you to pick a shop, and then you can go on for the transaction. Honestly, I won't show it again, because we will spend the afternoon on it. So I will go back to my presentation. Okay. So the technical stack. Okay. Sorry. Yes. So what's happening when you are sending a message to your Google Assistant? A message is sent to the assistant, and it's always related to what we call a dialogue flow project. Dialogue flow is a natural language processing tool. It's a tool that is helping the developer to understand what the user said. Okay, so this first step is important because you will always have the Google Assistant filter that will receive the user message and that will let some message go to your project and that will stop some message. For example, if you say, I want to cancel, it will quit automatically the application, excepting if you cut something specific for that. Or also, Google Assistant will provide you with some specific helpers. And for the specific case of transaction, I won't handle the transaction myself. I mean, when I'm displaying to the user a transaction order, if the user is saying anything, I will never know it. I will just receive from Google Assistant a message saying the user agreed to proceed to the transaction, go on. It's not me that have the responsibility of confirming that the user agreed or denied the transaction. So we decided that we didn't wanted to use dialogue flow in its full power here. So we defined only two intents on the first step of dialogue flow, which are the default welcome intent I was talking about, which is starting the application, and this cancel intent to avoid the app to close, because it's in our topic to have some client asking, for example, to cancel an order. If the user is saying, like, I want to cancel my order and the application crash, it will be difficult to justify this. So for everything else, I'm setting what we call a fulfillment request. What does it mean? A fulfillment request is just a webhook. So in short, it's the URL of my web service. And once any user message is received, I will receive the user message on my stack, on my web service. So I put it on Firebase. Why? Usually I was using AWS, but for those who know FNAC, it's a main French retail company. So when the client understood that we were using their main competitor, they just asked us to quickly change our hosting provider. So as Firebase was very well integrated with all the Google Assistant environment, we went for that. Also, just for information, I've been using Node.js because I love this language and it was perfectly suiting our situation. And we have been using some library provided by Google, so mostly actions on Google, which provide many helpers to answer to the question. So, yeah, what do we do in first? We are calling Dialogflow again. So the question could be, why the first Dialogflow here is not giving you some information about what the user said? Because it's a choice we made. It's maybe not the best, but we wanted to be able to do multiple things. We wanted to be able to switch our NLP tool, like the real heart of the application, anytime. Why? Because we wanted to test different solutions. There is not only the Dialogflow, you have Wit.ai, you have Recast, you have Lex. And because for our startup, we need to compare all this NLP tool, we wanted to use this project. It's also because we have some other similar projects that don't want us to use US solution for that. Then we can use Firebase Real-Time DB to check some data, for example, if you have a favorite shop. And then we can call Fnac API to get, for example, of course, the list of products or to get logged in. Then we send back a response to the assistant. And finally, if it's correctly formatted, the user will see it. If you do a mistake, the app crash. So you have to be careful. Then a bit of vocabulary. I was talking about intents. And intents, it's a label to just define what is the user will. Once you have this intent, you can analyze the sentence and extract what we call entities. The entities, it's just some words in your sentence that will help you to understand the user intention. All of this is trained thanks to a corpus of phrases. It means that you will express in different ways the same intent with different entities. It's just to be sure your bot will understand as many ways of saying something as possible. So as example here, you can see some sentence that express the need to find a product. So I can add some entities. You can see filters and categories. So my categories, it can be movies, DVDs. And in pink, we have Casablanca, which is the name of a famous old movie. And what I wanted to highlight there is that if you want to say, I want to find a bike, it's easy. But if you have something like looking like a city, natively, Dialogflow will understand it as a city. Or if I want the name, I don't know, of a movie or a book that is looking like another sentence, it's quite difficult to catch this entity as a product. So you have two solutions, or you can upload your full list of products on Dialogflow. You can upload until 30,000. But with our client, FNAC, you have many movies, books, products. I don't know exactly how many products I have, but it was much more than that. So we have been training, and honestly, right now, we have maybe 300 sentences, and it's still not perfect, to be honest. So now a little bit more, the concept of context. I think you all know what means context. So here it will be your conversation context. It's the fact that what is relative to the conversation should be always in the current context. Okay. I mean, if previously you picked a product, when you are about to confirm the transaction, the bot should know which product you picked before. It seems logical. I could save it in DB, but it's quite still a little bit faster to have this information directly. And Dialogflow let us do that by sending something which is named dialog state. So when you send an answer to the user, you send the dialog state along, and when the user replied to you, you get back the dialog state. So you really know what was the user status at a given time. The action. So the action, it's a simple concept. It's the fact that when Dialogflow understands an intent, Or, you can set up the answers in Dialogflow, or you can set up the webhook URL. It's the fulfillment of your intent on Dialogflow. It's important, I will explain after. It's simple, but important. And the agent is your project on Dialogflow. It's everything. It's the intent, the entities, your training sentence, and all your settings. So the Dialogflow UI is looking like this. On the left side, you can see we have many things. I won't detail because it would be a full talk. So you can set up your intent, entities, but your fulfillment, but you can also set up some integration with many messaging solutions. You have a super nice training section where you can train your bot with various sentences. You can see what the people have been saying to Dialogflow. You have some analytics. On this side, you can also send any sentence to Dialogflow and check if it's working fine. Okay. Action on Google. Actions on Google, so at the beginning I find it complicated because Action on Google is a platform where you set up your Google Assistant application. So there you... Oh, sorry. So it will be related to the previous Dialogflow project. But this, so the previous Dialogflow is really the NLP, and here it will be your application. So you will set up all the app generic information, the language in which your application will be available, and also what we saw, the invocation sentence. So for me, it was speak with Fnac. You can style it also, it's new since Google I/O. So you can have, for example, a nice background in your application to really understand that you are out of the Google Assistant context. And you can set up your actions. So I will explain a little bit after. And activate transaction. I'm telling this because it's a small checkbox in a small drop-down menu. It's easy to miss it. And this is also where you will set up your account linking. So the account linking is necessary if you will use the payment solution of your client. Because at one point, you will need to one authentication solution. And this is the one that is proposed by Google. Also, you set up the surface capabilities. It's important. It's where your application will be available. If you check that you absolutely need a screen, you will not be able to invoke your app on Google Home, because Google Home doesn't have a screen. All of this is important because once you submit your application, all this set of settings is frozen. Like, for real, you really submit everything you have set up. So if you did a spelling mistake, if you uncheck something, if you were trying any type of settings at the time of submission, if you edit it in the back office, it won't affect your production app. You will have to cancel the review and submit a new app. And honestly, it can be an issue. It has been for us. So, yes, the action. So, why do I focus on it? Because it, we decided to put most of the logic on our backend instead of Dialogflow. So we always call the fulfillment request. We just have two actions, I told you, the welcome intent and the cancel intent. They are set up in a JSON file that we were able to upload with a single line, a command line. So we set up it for good once, and everything was perfect. And in fact, we realized that if you test something in the Dialogflow UI, you can update your actions that we were thinking that were frozen. So you have two ways of updating your actions. And without actions, you cannot invoke your application. So now Firebase, just very quickly, it's a backend as a service. It was very useful because we didn't need something crazy. So we used Firebase function, which were serverless, and Firebase database that is an OSQL DB that was perfectly fitting what we needed because it's a chatbot. We went for the cheap, for the Blaze plan, because you cannot use the free plan if you need to ping external APIs. It's free only if you stay in the Google environment. It was well integrated in the Dialogflow ecosystem. Client was happy. They have a really simple CLI tool. And also for me, that wanted, I mean, usually I'm taking care of the infrastructure, but here I was discovering a new hosting solution. And here I had nothing to do. Honestly, it's perfect for developers that don't want to take care of the IT. You have everything, the analytics, the logs, the user management. You don't have anything to do. Okay, now just a small word about the packages. You have a Firebase function package that lets you set up some environment variable and handle the function export for the serverless. So once again, you have just to require and init something, and then it's okay. I didn't put the code because I would be late. Also, the action on Google, it's where you have most of the logic. So it lets you handle what we call the intent mapping. It's what I was explaining earlier when you are using a specific helper from Google, like for the transaction. You will receive a specific built-in intent saying transaction check, for example. And I should map this intent to a specific function on my side that will handle the payment. Also, I can get many user information. I can get his name, I can get his token, I can know what he has been clicking on the carousel. I can also generate the rich response. This is how I will generate the carousel, the list. And there are also all these helpers, for example, to get a user location, to help him to get logged in, and proceed to the transaction. So on your side, if you want to go for a project like this with a client, what you need, of course, is a working API. But for this, you can ask them to see the previous talk. It needs to be efficient, because if you don't reply anything in 5 seconds, the application just closes. It's saying something bad occurred. Down. Also, you need to be able to support all the Google payments or to support OAuth login to then handle the payment on your side. Bonus, it could be seamless account linking. So this is the ability to directly create a new account with only the Google data. You will see that Fnac login UI was not very good. For now, we are like, well, I will explain. And for now, FNAC does not support Google payment solution. That makes things a little bit more complex, because when you use a Fnac credit card, you need to add your credit card on the website of Fnac, proceed to one payment for real on the Fnac website, and then you can use it later, because they would require some checks for the payment, like the CVC, the number behind your credit card. So transaction, what's happening? First, you get user information. So what is buying, where, payment solution. Then you will generate what you saw before. This is the order explanation. So you have two choices, or you can buy, or you can cancel. This, I'm not handling that. I will only receive the answer of this. And depending on the user answers, I will proceed to the payment and update the user if it was successful or not. And if the user wants to edit something, he will just go for the edition flow. So the requirement for this, first, of course, you need to obtain this famous transaction. And you will be only able to test it on Android M and N, and on iOS. But on iOS, your app will crash on login. But if you restart it, it will work. They are working on it. We have open bug. You can't proceed to payment on Google Home. And you are not supposed to be able to do it on the web simulator, because it does not support WebView. But if you already logged in on your phone, you will be able to do it in the simulator. So first time we did it, it was surprising. Also, there is a sandbox mode. It's supposed to be mandatory. Fnac API didn't have it. So if it's activated, you're supposed, so this is a dollar, you're supposed to not proceed to the real transaction. FNAC didn't have it. So I had to cancel everything I bought. I forget sometimes, so I have maybe 20 books everywhere in France waiting for me. And you need also to submit it through the console. And you need to make sure that your current settings in the back office are working. Because sometimes you are testing something, you can change the version. It can be different than what you are currently submitting. So at one point, we submitted something, we were sure it was working. And in fact, each time Google people were testing it, it was not. So you should be careful. Then what else? Payment solution. So I told you, you can use your own payment method. You can use a Google-provided method. So for that, you need to add your credit card on Google Payment. Funny story, maybe 3 months ago, it was mandatory to add your credit card on your Google account, even if you were not paying with Google. So we were losing a lot of users on this. Or you can choose a payment on fulfillment. In short, it's free. It's like if you were just doing booking something and paying on delivery. Ah yes, and the template using are very sensitive. If you do a mistake, I told you when you send something back to the assistant, you will see a well-formed response, but you won't see anything on your screen, and sometimes you won't see any error message. So it's very complicated to debug. You will have to generate an order ID that you will send to Google, and Google will send you back on confirmation a Google order ID that you will have to store if you want later to update the users, to push update about the current status of your order. Login, I'm a little bit late, so we'll go quickly. In short, I have nothing to do excepting setting this in the UI. It's OAuth 2.0, so in short, user is logging on Fnac. It's sending a token on Google, and then Google take care of renewing the token, and I have a function to get the token. So I just require a token and send it to the API. I have nothing to do. I'm happy. So it's looking like this. In short, we are asking you, do you want to connect? You have a big explanation about the payment. You pick your Google account, and then you have the UI. And here the issue is that we can navigate on the website because it's like the real mobile UI, and we should not do that on Assistant. So the challenges, I'm almost done. It was the fact to handle the voice conversation. So we can detect if you are on a Google Home or on a phone. From this, we decide if, we will have different flow. For example, I won't read the 10 elements of the carousel. It would be super boring. So we are reading one element per one element, and the user can say next, next, next. Also, you have to consider the fact that the user can say anything anytime. It's different from a website. A user cannot click even on the page he cannot see. Right now, he can say what he wants. Also, we can play with the voice with some SSML markup. So you can slow down, you can pronounce some word in a specific way. Depending on how you write stuff, it can be said 3.14, 3.14 euro, or 3.14 euro. So you have to listen to the voice, especially in France. Sometimes it's unexpected, I would say. Also, you have to make the user to repeat what the user said, and sometimes insist on the confirmation. Because Google Assistant is not perfect, and sometimes it's not understanding the proper book name. Or sometimes it's catching some word and it's not what you wanted to say because the microphone was open and you were just asking to your friends to do something. And the user should always know what he can do. This is what is not dead, and you will always help him to know where is he in the flow and saying, like, you can do this, this, or this with some suggestion. And surface end off is the fact that when you are on your Google Home and about to pay, we will ask you to switch on your phone. You will receive a notification, and on click on it, you will directly land on the login and then proceed to the transaction. And So in terms of challenge, APIs, the documentation is awesome, but it's very big and it has been changing a lot. For example, we developed our code for V1 of Dialogflow, and V2 has been released last month. So our version is deprecated already. SDK template they are complex to debug. I told you, sometimes you just have no error message. So honestly, thank you, Internet, and thank you, Google Engineer, to help us. The assistant max time response, we have seen 5 seconds. Client APIs, like any client APIs, it was buggy. And no, this I won't talk about it, it's too long. And training the dialogue flow. Especially the product detection, I told you, it's still not perfect, and we are applying some regex in our code to as a backup. And a small wink to this morning talk, test with the right people. Because I really thought at one point I've been training very, very well my bot, and in fact, each time someone new is testing, is asking things I never thought about it. And also, yes, the release, be careful, plan it early. Just a few days ago, we were live, and suddenly it has been shut down for no official reason. But anyway, there are some specific fields a little bit hidden that are mandatory, and sometimes you can be refused because you didn't fill them. Also, a transaction application is going through mystery shoppers. If they feel any issue while trying to buy something on your application, you will be refused. And you don't know them, they just give sometimes like very weird feedback, like maybe this. Just imagine your mother is trying to buy something on your phone, in short. And yes, the payment solution, I told you we got some issue, for example, Google do not support CVC check. So our expectation, Google Cloud Function, in short, I would like a smoother UI because many things are laggy, especially the access to the logs. And I would like at least not the long-term service, so Node 8 supported, because right now it's only Node 6. And for the transaction, I would like to customize it a bit more because for now there are many information that we cannot put and that would be mandatory for our client. Better iOS support because my colleague is having iOS and it's crashing all the time. It's boring. Clearer submission flow because we have been really blocked many times. CVC support because it means we cannot pay anything more than 70 euros. And maybe one day it's voice transaction, so you would be at your home and just ask, I don't know, please book Uber for 5 minutes. Okay. Yes, thank you very much.